Michael Vincent testing one. Well, good afternoon, my friends. I hope you've all enjoyed the brand new start to 2024. New Year's Day is always a day of quiet reflection, and I just want to thank all of you for your kind comments on the video I posted only a few days ago. And now I'm delighted to share with you one of the brand new projects I'm bringing to my YouTube channel, Michael Vincent Magic. I've always had it in mind to do a series of videos which reviewed some of the great books on sleight of hand magic that have come out in the last few years. This was inspired by a video that I shared several years ago on my favorite magic books. I'm sure many of you have seen that video. If you haven't, please check the link in the description box. Click on it and give yourself a good 25, 30 minutes with a cup of tea to watch it, because you'll learn about some of the books I read as a boy that really inspired me to pursue magic as an academic subject, technical discipline, and a study in artistic expression. And those books still continue to inspire me to this very day. Well, this brand new series continues in the same vein, because rather than an ongoing look at several books, I'm just going to use this video platform to now focus on individual books that have come into my world and really added to my database of knowledge. Now, let's talk about that for a moment. Database of knowledge. Right here is the most incredible hard drive ever created. It's more powerful than the most superhuman computers available today. It can process data faster than the blink of an eye. So when I say database of knowledge, I literally mean information that gets stored in my brain, my subconscious, my super subconscious. And that database of knowledge is critical, because the more we study any given subject, that information that gets stored in our brain, our filing cabinet, for want of a better word, we can now access very quickly when we are engaged in some creative decision making about how we want our magic to look and feel for our audience. So today I'd like to debut this first video with a review and personal reflection on one of the most beautiful magic books that has ever come into my orbit and held in my hands. When I say beautiful, to me, this book is beautiful on so many levels. And I want to pay tribute now to the wonderful magician, Helda Guimarães. And I'm holding in my hand this glorious, magnificent book that we now know as Secret Language, Volume 1. When I first got news about this book being released, I had no idea that it would be such a mammoth book. This is a coffee table book, and this book appeals to me on so many levels. You may not know this, but I'm a very passionate photographer. My moniker is Fuji Warrior, okay? And I specialize in the human face, portraits, travel photography, and also photojournalism, documenting my travels, people, places, culture. So the reason why this book appeals to me so much is because of the quality of the photographs. It's a coffee table book. You don't travel around the world with this. As a matter of fact, this is not my personal copy. It belongs to my friend Michael Kulik, who I have the privilege of sharing time with over the last few weeks. I asked him if he would bring this so that I could study it. So here it is. This is Helda's wonderful book. And let me just open a random page, and it will give you a sense of the density of the written text, but also how the photographs have taken center stage, showcasing Helda's hands in action, executing some of the most exquisite sleight of hand and movements and choreography and so forth. So for me, when I open this book, I get tremendous joy just from looking at the photographs. So let me just check who took the photographs. Brad Fulton, and the design by Fulton and Catarina Marquez, Marquez, Portuguese name, Catarina, Helda's wife. beautiful, exquisite on so many levels. If you have this book, I'm sure you'll agree with me. It's a joy to own this book. Just to own it, to look at it, to hold it, put it on your table and study it. I got this book a few years ago and it's taken me this long to digest it, process the information, and just to allow Helder's thoughts to speak to me. Here's a question for you. When you buy a new magic book, what specifically are you looking for? Is it an author that whose work you inspire to study? For me, that was always Darwin Ortiz. Okay, I love Darwin's book and I bought them without question. Are you looking for new routines? If you're looking for new routines, you'll find them in Helder's book, no question about it. But I'd like to offer you a personal point of view. Take that as a given. You will find new routines. Maybe you won't, but the odds are in our favor because the books that are being published today by certain individuals who I will be addressing in future videos, the work is of a very high standard. Okay. But that's not all. I remember when I was a boy first reading Ultimate Card Secrets by Di Vernon, the last book in the Inner Secrets trilogy. There's a chapter dedicated to Larry Jennings, and I remember these words like I read them yesterday. He said, reading the work of great magicians is like taking a walk inside their mind to see how they think, how they overcame problems, their design process, the choices they made. And this has always stayed with me. And to be honest with you, this is what I look for. So when I study the work of specific individuals, I am immersing myself into the quality of their thinking. Not to copy, I think it was Dr. Stephen Covey who once said in The Habits of Highly Effective People, one of the first laws, seek to understand before making yourself understood. Understanding is key. So when I read this book by Helder, I'm seeking to understand who he is, why does magic mean so much to him, and why did he make the choices that he did regarding his original compositions. I'm going to be straight with you, and I'm sure if Helder sees this video, I think he may appreciate what I'm about to say. I'm not looking to copy his work because I'm not Helder Guimarães. I'm Michael Vincent, and I'm only interested in one thing, the Vincent touch, the Vincent self-expression. That's all I'm interested in. And I gravitate to this kind of work because it's a model for artistic composition, artistic excellence, artistic self-expression. And this is the path that I'm walking right now. What is my self-expression? What tools am I going to need to authentically express myself through my magic? And reading a book like this has been a wonderful process for my own creative understanding of how my brain works, how I think, the magic that appeals to me, how I want my magic to look. Okay, this book is a wonderful journey that has no specific ending. So it's a process. Okay, so let's talk about what makes this book special. In the first half of the book, Helder walks us through some of his aesthetic choices regarding card handling. I'm not going to talk about specific techniques. Get the book and study it and replay this video. You'll understand what I mean. Let me rephrase that. Artistic expression in card handling when doing certain techniques. I had never quite articulated it in the way that I just did, but this is my interpretation of what I've studied. The aesthetics of how the cards look in my hand, the aesthetics of how the cards behave when I'm executing certain things. How do my hands get into certain positions when executing certain techniques? Does this feel right to me? The simple squaring action that covers one of the most important techniques in card magic. How cards are turned, placed on the table to cover certain techniques. To me, this is a beautiful thing and very important for me because I have a very extremely vivid imagination. One of my core goals as a magician is to ask this question. Sorry, not magician, but architect of strong magic. I am an architect of strong magic. I'll come back to that in just a moment. As an architect of strong magic, I always ask myself this question. If I had the power of a real magician, what would it look like? And to answer that question, I do a 180 degree turn and put myself out there in the audience watching myself do a classic piece of magic. I visualize it, I close my eyes, I daydream, and I can see it. And if I can see it, I own it. And once I take ownership of my vision, guess what? The work begins. I then work backwards. How am I going to arrive at that outcome? To me, this is the most glorious way to create magic. Put the cards down for a moment and visualize. How do you want it to look? What experience do you want your audience to have during your performance? How do you want them to feel? What do you want them to say when your performance is all over? Get out your notebook and write those questions down. And do not settle for anything less than what your creative imagination can conjure up in your mind. This is where the real magic lives. This is just the pathway that we can carve out to create our colorful vision, okay? This book is part of the process. Aesthetics, how certain things can and should look. Refinement in our card handling. There's a certain beauty and elegance in seeing sleight of hand executed, and you don't see or feel anything suspicious has happened. Take it from me. Helder's one of the few magicians that has fooled me badly. I saw him at FISM over 25 years ago in Stockholm. He won first prize for card magic. He did things with a deck of cards I had never seen before. My memory of what he did is pretty vivid. Blank cards, signed cards on the faces, spectator names a card, and the blank cards change with their signatures still on them. Try and visualize that. Quite extraordinary. I would never have imagined that he's become a major player now in the artistic expression of great, beautiful card magic. Well, guess what? He has. This book proves it. Because when you get into the section on his compositions, well now, he has taken classic plots, beautiful premises, and orchestrated original handlings into some of the most exquisite card magic. I'm not going to perform anything from this routine for this video camera. I don't want to. In fact, I made a promise to myself. I'm not going to perform anything from this routine. But what I will do is do everything in my power to understand his thinking and train of thought as to why he made the choices he did to come up with these beautiful compositions. Excuse me. What I have done is taken some of the strategies that I've learned and applied them to the magic I already perform. And let me tell you, guess what? My work has become even stronger, far more compelling, engaging. My audience rapport has gone through the roof. I'm very proud because I never thought I would live to see the day where I can engage an audience with nothing but a deck of cards and my words. It's this thing of exquisite beauty. And this book is an access to doing this for yourself. Let me just give you a lowdown on some of the routines in here that has caught my attention. Blah, 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 da, 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 da. Two card transposition. There's a routine here which is a combination of Hofzinser's Everywhere and Nowhere and the general card. If you read this and can visualize it, it would be impossible. But guess what? Helder did. He saw it and he created the handling and procedure to arrive at an elegant solution. Professional hour. Well, this routine's very interesting to me because I studied the original by a wonderful Spanish magician named Pepe Carroll, and We now know this routine as suit appearance. I studied this back in the 80s when 52 Lovers was first published. I couldn't quite make sense of the written description, but I understood what the effect was, and I worked out my own handling. Did I ever perform it? No, because I didn't feel mature enough at the time for such a complex composition. But over the years, I kept returning to this routine, and eventually I came up with my own original handling and presentation for what could be considered suit appearance, but it's more closely aligned to matching the cards, okay? And my routine is very, very close to what's published here, okay? It's not copying, no, but I was intrigued to apply some of the thinking in Helder's routine to the routine that I was already working on. My routine has become just that little bit better. It's become a very tight composition. There is nothing in my routine that doesn't need to be there. And there's a key element in the routine that I needed to re-choreograph. Why? Because the handling at that point in the routine only existed so that I could do what needed to be done. And to me, this was not good design. I needed to redesign it so I could do what needed to be done as a natural flow of what was already taking place, not as an isolated incident. I'm being very cryptic in my language right now because I refuse, absolutely refuse to give away secrets on YouTube. No, do your homework, study the books, do your own thinking. Do not base your repertoire on what you see other magicians do. You want respect for your magic? Create your own material, or at the very least, come up with an original expression of a classic routine. That would get my attention more than people ringing me up on the telephone and saying, hey, Mike, I love your routine for such and such a routine. Can I perform it? No, you can't. Leave it alone. I lost count of the number of times I've got communication from certain people wanting to do my routines. I bet you any money they're doing it, but I don't know because they're not living in the same town as I am. They're in another part of the world. You know what? Their conscience will bug them. I'm not going to worry about it. That's karma for you. So part of my commitment to the material in this book is to honor Helder's work and to take what's published here and take it further. Because let's be honest, every one of us has gaps in our thinking. And those gaps are waiting to be filled by someone who sees a possibility. I've taken the work of Darwin Ortiz and made it better for myself. And I'm not saying Darwin's routines are incomplete. He took his routines as far as he needed to go. I took it a step further. Why? Because I'm not a gambling expert. I'm a storyteller. So how can I take a gambling routine like The Sting, for example, and make it work for me? How can I take the material in Helder's book and make it work for me? These are very important questions and considerations. And I got to tell you, it's quite magnificent. I will tell you one thing. There's a routine in this book. I won't tell you what it is, but I will say it's one of my favorite premises in magic, card magic. And I performed it in a public show. It just so happened there was a magician in the audience and he came up to me afterwards and he said, Michael, that routine that you did, I have no idea. And all I said was, very kind of you to say so. Thank you. I did not engage in any further conversation because this routine, I added my own original. When I say original, I mean it. There's no narrative like it for this particular routine in this book. I've taken one of Elder's ideas and expanded it with an original narrative. And unfortunately, I'm very protective of it. So not too many magicians will see me perform this routine. It's for lay people. Only in my private one-man shows. Anyway, be that as it may, the last part of this book is based on theory. So let's go through this. Part one, choreographies and techniques. Part two, essays, repertoire. Part three, theory. Okay, and he talks about the magic, concept, expression and approach, construction, the intellectual and emotional side of the construction of powerful magic, the internal and external life of a composition, unity, harmony, balance, contrast, emphasis. This really appeals to me because these are languages that apply to my photography. Okay? Performance, movement, rhythm, order, style, and mystery. That elusive element that we may never truly understand, but we strive to make sense of. What is mystery? What is magic? It's important to be able to have an expression for these terms. or at the very least, come up with some ideal of what magic means to you. And for me, I'll just share with you my vision for magic is to provide my audience with the most extraordinary experience they have ever had. Not only that, I want the experience of my magic for my audience to challenge and confront their point of view of the world they live in and the reality that they experience on a day-to-day basis. So my friends, Volume 1, Secret Language by Helder Guimarães is one of the greatest books on sleight of hand cardmage I have ever held in my hand. It's one of the most beautiful academic studies I have ever engaged in regarding sleight of hand card magic. It has completely reframed the way I look at my own handling process when it comes to the execution of sleight of hand. How do I want my sleights to look? It's completely reframed how my hands work in relationship to a deck of cards. Over the last, I would say 18 years, I've become fascinated with the architecture of strong magic. And my friend Darwin Ortiz wrote a book called Designing Miracles. I will, in fact, do a review on this book. But for now, let me just lay a foundation because it applies beautifully to this book, Secret Language. The architecture of strong magic involves the design, the vision, the blueprint. Once you have that, you then have to look at the structure. What is going to hold your vision up to be exalted? Standing ovation. Once you've got the structure in place, do you have the requisite tools to begin the construction phase? The construction phase. And once the construction begins, is it finished? No. The construction will fit and dovetail beautifully into the structure and design. However, my experiences has taught me, keep an open mind, remain flexible in my knowledge and understanding of how card magic works. Why? Because as time goes by, once I start performing an original composition, guess what's going to happen? I'm going to make changes. I'm going to make adjustments. I'm going to refine my handling detail. It's the little details that make the big difference. Details make the difference. This is why I videotape all my performances, right? Because I need to see what I need to see. And when I've seen what I need to see, guess what? Back to the drawing board to make those finesses and adjustments. And the time comes when I need to make finesses on the finesse. And all of this does is polish and shine a beautiful expression of magic. So today has been my attempt to shed a spotlight on this glorious book. If you have it, please leave a comment down below. Share with me what you think of Secret Language. If you don't have it, get in touch with Helder, see if he has any copies available, and put this book on your wish list for 2024, all right? Because it will enrich your love and appreciation for strong magic. And you know what? I really love the phrase, the architect of strong magic. That's who we are. That's what we do. Okay? And let's get on with it. Let's do the work. Let's learn from each other. Don't copy. Learn. Seek to understand. And allow that understanding to inform your own creative and artistic self-expression. So that's it for today. I hope you enjoy this video and I hope you feel as enthusiastic about Secret Language as much as I do. This is Michael Vincent signing off. I hope you enjoyed this new video. If you would like to see more of it, leave a comment. That's the only way I'll know because I've got a number of books that I want to talk about and share my thoughts with you. That's it for now. Greetings from Poland, and let's make 2024 the most magical year of our lives. This is Michael Vincent signing off. Ciao. See you soon.